York City. It's the Gary Null Show.
This will be an everlasting love. This will be the one I've waited for. This will be the first time anyone has loved me.
And now, your host, Gary Null.
Everyone, I'm Gary Null, broadcasting on location today. We're going to begin with the latest on the consumption of processed meat, which most Americans consume on a regular basis, from Harvard School of Public Health, and then from there take you on a journey of the latest from all over the world on how to live a longer and healthier life. Then we're going to go to some important clips. We're going to have a mother explain why she decided for a period of time to homeschool her children, what benefit came from that. Because today, especially in California, a lot of mothers are choosing to do some, not necessarily all, a homeschooling. My own daughter did homeschooling on her children for about 4 years, and they turned out really good. And I think that we should be open to homeschooling, especially if people know the pros and cons of it. Then we're going to hear from about the racist history of illegal immigration. We're also going to explore why student debt is out of control. And if we really cared about all of our young people in school, why would we, I believe we should forgive that debt. And also, how reliable is your memory? At a time when we're asked to believe anyone bringing a charge against anyone that they're right and the person's automatically guilty. So start the vilification and crucifixion process. I'm so opposed to that. I'm so opposed to the assumption, the arrogance, the hubris of people assuming because you make an allegation that you do not need proof, you do not need anything other than a person's word or the emotion that they show when they're presenting themselves, because they can be wrong. And so we're going, yesterday, at least for many of our stations, you heard one of the world's leading authorities, if not the world leading authority on false memory. And she holds 3 doctorates, including in law, professor of law and psychology. And she has been able to get so many people out of prison because the accusations against them were false. Today, we're continuing with that by showing you how our memories can be completely false. And therefore, we should be very careful at examining all the evidence before we make up our mind about the guilt or innocence of anyone. And we have to separate out and not conflate what we may feel politically about someone versus what is being said about them. And that's what we're not doing at this time. By the way, yesterday, the prosecutor dropped all charges, as did the judge, against 4 dentists who had been arrested because a woman claimed that one of them had she had met at a bar in a Las Vegas hotel, had taken her back to his room, and then she was gang raped by 4 people. Turned out none of it was true. Could you imagine if they hadn't looked at the security tapes? Could you imagine if it was just her word and no other evidence that was necessary? How many people are in prison today because a cop, a prosecutor, someone decided to lie? Well, according to the latest studies, it's over 41% of all people incarcerated. Well, if you go back the last 20 years, you're talking about 7 million people who were innocent were falsely accused. I just think we had better stop for a moment and ask, do we really care about the rule of law? Do we care about evidence? Do we care about examining that evidence honestly and objectively? We're going to continue on this. Now, that's our show today, so we have a lot to share with you. And we'll be asking for your calls later on some of these topics that we explore. But only after we share what the experts were bringing in, then you can give your point of view. Published in the International Journal of Cancer is an article where research was done at Harvard School of Public Health. and they examined studies on red or processed meat consumption and found a direct link to increased breast cancer risk. That's important. So when you compare the highest to the lowest category in 15 studies, including the analysis of processed meat, that's what you would have on a bologna sandwich or a pizza, and you increase the risk of breast cancer. Plain and simple. Now, you can go into why and how, but for most people, it should be enough to say, stop for a moment. When you eat a pizza and you have that processed meat on it, that salami, you're increasing your risk of breast cancer. Now, here it is. Were there any studies on prostate cancer, which is also a hormone-related cancer? Not yet, but we must open ourselves up to the opportunity to say if something in the scientific literature with 15 studies showed an association with breast cancer by eating this, could it not also show that same association with prostate cancer? And the answer is yes. So whether you choose to eat the wrong food or not, at least know the risks are there. From University of Minnesota Medical School, they show how to slow down the aging process. They show that there's a natural way to reduce the level of damage cells are experiencing in the body, causing us to prematurely age. Previous research published this year in Nature Medicine involving University of Minnesota Medical School faculty found that it is possible to reduce the burden of damaged cells, termed senescent cells, and extend the life of the person and improve health even when treatment was initiated later in life. So it's not too late, even if you're 70 or 80 or 90. They now have shown that treatment of aged people with a natural product called Feistin, F-I-S-E-T-I-N. And by the way, you find that in your fruits and vegetables, really find a lot of it in berries, has the effects that are positive on health and extending lifespan. Now, why? And this is an area of my expertise. I spent 33 years as a research fellow at the Institute of Applied Biology in anti-aging medicine. I did some other research there as well, but it was anti-aging that was my number one interest. And I did over 164 original in-depth studies, some of those studies taking 2 to 3 years. And all of it led back to the same thing, all of it. If you provide clean, healthy, and nutrient-rich fruits, vegetables, nuts, seeds, legumes, tubers, it then provides less, and here's the takeaway message, less inflammation at the cellular level. And that inflammation, no matter what the source, whether it's a cytokine or a tumor necrosis factor alpha or an interferon, no matter what the source or prostaglandin, it can cause damage. Now, the best science I can find shows that we have about 10,000 gene alterations every 24 hours. So do the math. Let's just say that you're an average-sized person and you have 75 trillion cells in your body. You have more bacteria than that by 10 times, but just cells. That means that you have 75 trillion times 10,000. That is why some people look better and are healthier at one age than someone else, same age, but who has not made healthy choices. So every single unhealthy choice in life, you pay a price. It's just that you don't see that price until you reach a certain tipping point. No one eats a hamburger and ends up with, no one has a glass of alcohol and ends up with cirrhosis of the liver. But now multiply that by thousands of cigarettes and hundreds or thousands of glasses of alcohol, yeah, then you do. It's inevitable. But in our current medical model, for the majority of medical practitioners, they only recognize disease when there is a classical manifestation of symptoms. So you could suffer from subclinical scurvy or vitamin C deficiency or a subclinical vitamin D3 deficiency before you get rickets and brittle bones and compounding fractures. So you see, we can go a long time diseasing, where we're actually manifesting disease before we see an obvious symptom. So once a doctor says, good, we found the disease early, it really should be, wow, after 20 years or 30 years of smoking or drinking or eating bad food, we finally find the first clear evidence, classical evidence of a symptom. You're 20 to 30 years late to the party. So, as we age, we accumulate damaged cells. And when the cells get to a certain level of damage, they go through an aging process of their own called cellular senescence, S-E-N-E-S-C-E-N-C-E, senescence. The cells also release inflammatory factors that tell the immune system to clear those damaged cells. Now, a younger person's immune system is healthy and is able to clear the damaged cells. But as people age, they aren't cleared as effectively. Thus, they begin to accumulate, causing low-level inflammation and release of enzymes that can degrade the tissue. Well, what happened at Harvard was that these scientists found a natural product called Feistin, F-I-S-E-T-I-N, that's in berries and vegetables, that reduces the level of these damaged cells in the body. They found this by treating mice towards the end of life with this compound, and they saw improvements in the lifespan. The paper is entitled, Feistin is a sentiotherapeutic that extends health and lifespan. And it was published in eBioMedicine, a respected journal. Quote, these results suggest that we can extend the period of health, termed health lifespan, even towards the end of life. So, I think that's very, very exciting. Again, we share with you information on this program years, even decades ahead of when it ends up being popularized, if it ever is, in the mainstream media. For example, we were telling you about fiber and positive bacteria 25 years ago, 30 years ago, 40 years ago. Way ahead of the current fad in it. So that's good. Now, for those of you who want to be healthier, you know one more way to do it. Stay away from meat, because that's really bad for you. And especially women, that's a contributing factor to breast cancer. And so as long as we understand the problem, we can avoid it. Next up, newly discovered compounds shed fresh light on whole grain health benefits. This is from the University of Eastern Finland, and what it says simply is that scientists have found new compounds that can explain whole grain health benefits, and a high intake of whole grains increased the levels of betaine compounds in the body, which in turn was associated with improved glucose metabolism. That's good for pre-diabetics and diabetics. The findings shed light on the cell-level effects of a whole grain-rich diet and can help in the development of increasingly healthy food products. Quote from the study, whole grains are one of the healthiest foods there is. For instance, we know that a high intake of whole grain protects against type 2 diabetes and cardiovascular disease. Up until now, however, we haven't understood the cellular mechanisms through which a whole grain-rich diet impacts our body. But now they do. Using a metabolism analysis, they were able to investigate the effects of a whole grain diet on your metabolites, and that was the more fiber, the better, and also you get the endosperm, and you get the nutrients in major amounts. So. Good news there. So For those of you eating millet, maize, also rice, brown rice, and oatmeal, still cut oats, those are all good for you. Amaranth, quinoa, terrific for you. And they're inexpensive. So whole grains are inexpensive and easy to find. Next up, a grape nutrient protects against cancer. Brand new. This is from the University of Geneva. And what they found is that lung cancer, which is the deadliest form of cancer in the world, in fact, 80% of the deaths are related to smoking. In addition to tobacco control, effective, they're looking at chemo prevention, meaning what can you take in the body that can prevent this? And lo and behold, they found something that I first mentioned to you over 22 years ago, resveratrol, res, R-E-S, vera, V-E-R-A, trol, T-R-O-L, which is found in grapes. And while it is chemo preventative against cancers affecting the digestive tract, and it's been documented many times, there are over 5,000 studies on resveratrol, this is the first time that it's shown to actually benefit lung cancer. And that is terrific. So one more reason why grapes are so important. Grape juice, grape concentrate, grape powders. I have them every day because I know how important this is. So resveratrol for lung cancer prevention, that's good. Also from Wake Forest School of Medicine comes a study about how diet affects the breast microbiome in mammals. Diet influences the composition of microorganisms that populate the mammary glands, and including in primates, and we need to know that. We need to know all that can help us live a longer life. This was published in Cell Reports. And specifically, this study shows that the Mediterranean diet increased the abundance of probiotic bacteria previously shown to inhibit tumor growth in animals. Quote, we showed for the first time that breast-specific microbiome populations are significantly affected by diet, and it is the well-established non-human primate model of women's health, increasingly likely that these findings will be important for human health as well. Okay, takeaway from this. I have at my animal rescue sanctuary in Florida, to my knowledge, the oldest living ringtail lemur in the world. She is 32 going on 33. Now, if you Googled ringtail lemurs, they'll live 16 years average, a little longer or shorter. She's double that. So she's over 200 years, and she's active every day. And we had some young ones that came in that she grooms and plays with. And she's just, you know, she's the queen of the place. She's loving, and as all ringtails are, never bitten anything or anyone. Loves to be held and cuddled and hand-fed. She's spoiled. And she is really healthy, and that's because every morning I get up and I make all the animals a special drink. And the drink is what I also recommend to people I counsel, what I take myself. And it is loaded, I mean hyper-loaded, with natural occurring nutrients. So what would be normal is probably she's getting 10 times what is normal. And so there's no inflammation damaging those genes. And the less damage you have to genes, the longer that cell can exist in the body in a healthy way. You can reverse the damage of a gene. That's what I was saying earlier in that one study. So if you have 75 trillion cells, and you get 10,000 gene alterations a day because you're doing everything wrong. Now imagine if you did everything right. You might end up with 2,000 damaged cells instead of 10,000. You reduce the damage by 80%. Then there are nutrients like NAD and resveratrol and pycnogenol and coenzyme Q10 and L-carnosine that will go in there and actually lengthen the telomeres and enhance the cell, in which case then you're going to live longer. Sally, 25 years, the cat, healthy as can be, and And all the animals, I give them all the same quality food each day, and that's why they're vitally healthy. Vet comes out, gives an inspection, says, wow. Never saw a kitchen. I have a whole commercial kitchen with walk-in refrigerator with probably at any given time 30 different fresh organic fruits and vegetables, and watermelons and grapes, and everything is beyond that. All the water is filtered. Then it's washed again. A high level of sanitation, better than any restaurant I've ever seen. So if you want your dog, your cat, your bird to live longer, well, first, challenge vaccines for your animal. That'll kill them quickly. And secondly, give them more raw food. Remember, in nature, animals don't microwave food, you know, or get them salted and deep fried. They get them raw. Now, as long as they're getting clean water and they're getting abundant food when they need it, they'll double their lifespan more often than not. A lion in nature, 10 to 12 years, a little longer or shorter. In captivity, or in a sanctuary, let's say in Africa, where they're getting clean water and good food, but they're protected, 25 years, even 30 years in some cases. So that it's no different. It's no different for birds. You know, the healthier the food, every day. Certain fruit. There are certain ones you don't give, but there are certain fruits and vegetables you give every day, and clean water. The key is clean water, all the time, and then nutrients on top of that. Because I give a lot of nutrients on top of that, and if people did that, instead of just taking some dry food out of a, you know, kibble out of a bag or some processed meat that is not fit, in my opinion, for human consumption, you give that to your animal, cut their lifespan in half, 50% off their lifespan. I'm going to produce over the winter a documentary, A to Z, on how to double the lifespan of your pet, no matter what your pet. So finally, from the University of British Columbia, exercise reduces stress and improves cellular health in family caregivers, which means that exercising at least, in my opinion, 5 times a week, in this study for 3 times a week for 6 months, reduced stress in a group of family caregivers and even appeared to lengthen a small section of their chromosomes that is believed to slow the cellular aging process. So get out and exercise if you're a caregiver. You can live a longer life. Tomorrow I'm going to talk about understanding why women may age slower than men, and also how a low plasma coenzyme Q10 level is a prognostic factor for melanoma progression. So it'll come tomorrow. We are 23 minutes into our program. I'm broadcasting on location. I'm helping our sister station, WBAI, by having a group of people get healthy, and boy, are they getting healthy, and helping the station pay for premiums that it otherwise would not have the money to pay for, which it is doing, and so it's a win-win. Back in a moment. Please stay with us. Last night on the Progressive Commentary Hour, you were able to hear one of the most profound minds on the planet. And he is so unique in his insights. But a lot of people don't have the internet, especially a lot of the older people in this audience. They've told me that. So tomorrow on our sister station, WBAI in New York, we're going to play last night's program so you can hear this wonderful, very sensitive and intelligent person share with you about how you can live a longer and more more expanded life existence and what it's like to come up with these ideas that he has done so. So you won't want to miss that. And again, I'm doing that as a public service because not everybody can hear the Progressive Commentary, which, by the way, is the most popular program I do every week and has been for decades. And for everyone else, we'll do a regular show on PRN.fm. And we posted a lot of articles today. I posted over 60 different articles that can help people in different areas. Well, by the way, before we go, and we're going to go to a short clip in just a moment about the racist history of illegal immigration, and then we're going to why student debt is out of control, then the longer segment, how reliable is your memory, will finish off the program. I just want to mention that it's rare that I have a chance to hire someone to do important work from the audience, because it's generally very specialized work, and I have to find people who have those special skills. But I'm going to be hiring an animal caretaker who will be with animals each day, feeding them, cleaning their environment, spending quality time with them, giving them love, and it's a paying job. It's a good job. It's down at our sanctuary in Florida. If that interests you, you can send your resume and information and attention to send it to Joe. He's interviewing people. And it can't just like dogs and cats. No, you have to have experience. And send it to prnstudio@gmail.com. prnstudio@gmail.com. And it would be it's a wonderful, almost a gift position, because you're around all that wonderful, loving animals all day long. So until we find them homes, that's the object of the exercise. Find them a place they can spend the rest of their life. Those that we can let go back into nature, we do. Release back into the wilds. They've come to me damaged and hurt and abused, and we spend quality time so they can trust and love again. So that's that. Now, we're going to hear the racist history of illegal immigration. I think you'll find this interesting.
One of the most iconic symbols of America, a beacon of hope and acceptance for immigrants everywhere. So how did coming to this country become a crime?
Illegal alien.
If we look at the history of immigration in this country, being illegal usually just means being unwanted. And more often than not, that has to do with race and ethnicity. For a long time, there was no such thing as an illegal immigrant in the U.S. because there weren't any immigration laws. In the early days, European settlers came over and claimed Native American land as their own. And Africans were brought here against their will on slave ships. When the U.S. established a government, immigrants flocked to the land that promised equality and freedom. And the border was open. But very soon, it became clear that not everybody who could make it here was welcome. The Naturalization Act, signed by George Washington in 1790, said only white people could become citizens. And every wave of newcomers was met with resentment by the Anglo-Saxon Protestants who claimed they were here first. Even white immigrants like Italians and the Irish were discriminated against for being Catholic. By the late 19th century, immigrants from China were also living in the US. And as the country went through an economic recession, they became the target of blame for widespread unemployment. So Congress passed the Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882, the first major federal immigration law restricting entry into the US. It banned nearly all immigrants from China. This was the first time the federal government regulated who was a legal immigrant. Then in the early 1900s, eugenics became popular, which basically legitimized racism as science. It was founded on a racial hierarchy with the Northern Europeans at the very top. Its influence was so powerful that it was reflected in the next major federal immigration law signed in 1924. The law set up a nationality-based quota system that capped immigration from Southern and Eastern Europe and banned essentially all Asians. At this point, mentions of illegal immigrants started showing up in major newspapers. In the 60s, the US finally moved to get rid of the racist quota system. The 1965 Immigration and Nationality Act reopened borders to Asian immigrants, especially the professionals. But it also added restrictions to a different group. For the first time, there was a cap on immigration from Latin America. Almost overnight, many Mexicans and Latin Americans who legally crossed the border to find work, including those encouraged by a U.S. government program, suddenly became illegal. We are still dealing with the consequences of that law today. Those who are deemed illegal in this country have always changed with time. But the reason to keep certain groups out has remained the same. Newcomers, especially those who look different, are seen as a threat to white Americans' jobs, identities, and way of life. Who's considered legal all depends on when you start the clock.
Okay, that was just a reminder of our past. Now, we're going to go now to Professor Lauren Weinstein. She is an expert in strategic communication at Stanford Graduate School. And this was a TED Talk that she gave. And she's talking about, can we really trust our own recollections? I think you'll find this important. She also, by the way, has a Doctor of Jurisprudence from Stanford Law School, and also have a degree from Stanford University in psychology. Here she is talking about how reliable is your memory.
This elephant has incredible strength. She can uproot a tree with her trunk alone. Yet she will remain in captivity, held by only a light rope. Despite her ability to easily break away, she doesn't even try. Why? It starts when she's young. She's first tied down when she's small and not yet strong enough to break the rope. She will try at first, try as hard as she can to break free, and try, but eventually realize she can't. Suddenly, something attaches itself to her that is stronger than any rope or chain or fence. It's the belief that she can't break free. It's this belief that holds her back, despite her ability. I've had these same beliefs. You may have too. Beliefs that held me back. Beliefs that led me to feel unfulfilled in my work, to struggle in my relationships, and to live a life that was far from the one I'm living now. It was only when I became aware of my ropes and actively pulled against them that I found myself in a different reality. How do you break the ropes that tie you down? Don't believe everything you think. When I was 6 years old, I had a favorite babysitter, Amber. One morning, my mother told me we couldn't have her babysit because she didn't have enough money to pay her. So that afternoon, I started my first company. I gathered rocks from around the neighborhood, painted them with my art set, and went door to door selling them to our neighbors. That night, it was Amber and I on the couch together. When I was young, I was bold, outgoing, and fearless. I wore what I wanted, or didn't want to wear. Guided by my own voice that told me what would make me happy. I was also in love. His name was Fernando, and he was wonderful. As with everything else, I wasn't afraid to grab him with both hands. As I grew older, this picture started to fade. My exuberance was replaced with timidness, my leadership with conformity, my boldness with fear. I don't think any of us leave childhood without some ropes, despite our parents' best intentions. I grew up with a mother who was determined to give me the perfect life. Armed with love and good intentions, she did everything for me to help me be perfect. I'd pack a suitcase to go on a school trip, and she'd unpack it and repack it in a more perfect way. I'd be ready to turn in a school art project, and then she'd add her own brushstrokes to make it better. Later, she told me when my choice of boyfriend or apartment wasn't good enough. Although she just wanted what was best for me, I stopped knowing what was best for me. An unconscious rope was formed. I shouldn't trust my own voice and my own ability, and I feared not being perfect. Other ropes attached themselves too. I grew up in a family filled with yelling, loud voices, and strong opinions. To keep the peace, I learned to stay quiet, to not rock the boat, to become invisible. In school, I came to believe it's more important to blend in than stand out. And the pain of an early heartbreak led me to hold back in my relationships so I could avoid getting hurt. I'm not good enough. Don't speak up. Don't stand out. Fear failure. These were my ropes. This isn't just my story. Like the elephant, we all come to believe certain things in childhood that weren't true, or at least are no longer true, but we still live with them as if they are. If you've ever felt not good enough, alone, unwanted, unloved, invisible, powerless, like you don't belong, these are your ropes. If you've ever felt you can't trust yourself, trust others, speak up, stand out, ask for help, let others in, be accepted as you are, these are your ropes. These ropes hold us back. I found myself defaulting to others' opinions when I should have been trusting my own, staying quiet when it would have benefited me to speak up, and blending in when I would have been happier if I had the courage to stand out. This led me into a series of jobs that ranged from tolerable to miserable. In one, I hoped I'd get sick so I could stay home from work. It led me into a series of relationships in which I lacked confidence in myself, the other person, and the relationship. These never worked out. My beliefs affected the way I perceived the world, which changed how I acted, which led to a self-fulfilling prophecy. I felt small, and my world became smaller. What we believe has powerful effects. Decades of social psychology research backs this up. In a study performed at Dartmouth College, an ugly scar was placed on participants' faces with makeup. They were then sent into a room for a conversation and asked to report how people responded to them with this ugly scar. But here's the twist. Right before they left, the experimenter said, "Hold on a minute, we just want to touch up your scar a bit." Rather than touch it up, they removed it entirely. So unbeknownst to them, the participants went into their conversations looking completely normal. Despite this, they came back and reported how awkward their conversations were, how people avoided looking at their scar, had trouble making eye contact, and were tense and uncomfortable in the conversation. Their beliefs about their scar led them to see things that weren't really there and to make meaning of innocent behavior. What could have been a perfectly normal conversation instead became an awkward one. Their beliefs created their reality. Other studies show the same effect. Highlight an Asian woman's Asian identity before a math test, she'll perform better. Highlight her female identity, she'll perform worse. Lead a group of men to believe an athletic task is diagnostic of sports intelligence, white men perform better. Lead them to believe it's diagnostic of natural athletic ability, black men do. Give someone a white coat and tell them it's a doctor's lab coat, they'll perform better on an attention task than when told it's a painter's coat. In all of these cases, same people, same abilities, same tasks, different beliefs. And in each case, it was their belief that raised or lowered their performance. How you see yourself and your circumstances will affect what you see, how you act, and what occurs as a result. It's almost as if our beliefs place a virtual reality headset on us. A headset that allows us to see things that aren't really there and sends us into a false reality. We have these headsets even when they're miles from the truth. I remember hearing the top model, Cameron Russell, share how models, despite having the shiniest hair and the longest legs, are some of the most physically insecure people on the planet. An award-winning author, Lydia Yuknovich, shared how she didn't follow up on literary representation she was offered early in her career. The reason, in her words, we don't always know how to hope or say yes or choose the big thing, even when it's right in front of us. It's the shame we carry, the shame of not believing we deserve it. Our headsets have us living into a false reality. They also cause us to bump into each other. Once, I'd been dating someone for a few weeks. We'll call him Ben. We talked every day. Then he went on a work trip. For 4 days, silence. I didn't hear a word. How would you interpret this? What's the first thought that pops in your head? My beliefs led me to wonder what I had done or said to make this once enthusiastic person change his mind about me. I shared his silence with friends. One, who admits she has trouble trusting people, was sure he was on this trip with another woman. Another, who admits he's afraid of rejection, guessed he was probably upset because I hadn't invited him as my date to an upcoming wedding. And a third, who has trouble with commitment, guessed he probably thought we were moving too fast and was taking some space. Each person saw the same situation through the lens of their own headset. Who was right? How should I respond? Each of these assumptions leads to a different response. Moving too fast? I should pull back. But if he's feeling rejected, this will just hurt him more. Feeling rejected? I should up my calls and invite him to the wedding. But if he thinks we're moving too fast, this will just push him away further. I was so confused. As I was ping-ponging around in my own headset, while briefly borrowing some of my friends' headsets, this relationship died a slow death. Are you ready for what was going on in Ben's headset? He'd been deeply hurt by a past relationship, was afraid of getting hurt again, and pulled away when his insecurities got the best of him. It was none of the things anyone had guessed. Sometimes our headsets get in the way of our relationships. It took me a long time to learn this. Just as our beliefs can hold us back, they can also propel us forward. Let's go back to the scar study for a moment. Imagine the opposite. Imagine the researchers place something on the participants' faces that leads them to believe they look beautiful and then remove it before they go into the social setting. Now, what do you think they believe about others' responses? How do you think they show up differently? What difference does it make if you believe you're ugly or gorgeous, good at math or terrible at it, good at sports or not? It seems a big one. I finally learned this lesson. My headset led me to law school. There, my long-held false beliefs were reinforced. Aim for perfection, follow the crowd, fear failure. This was a familiar path. Then one day, without thinking much about it, I signed up for a class outside the law school called Design Thinking Bootcamp, a class that promised to unleash my creative potential. I had to design innovative products and experiences, or more accurately, pull on almost every single one of my ropes. I had to trust my own voice, because when it comes to innovation, there is by definition no one to look to for the answers. I had to put myself out there, because innovation doesn't come from playing it safe. And perhaps most importantly, I had to be willing to fail, to be willing to not be perfect. The best designs came only after multiple failed attempts. If I wanted to get it right, I first had to be willing to get it wrong. I struggled in this class because all of the things that would help me succeed were the same things I'd believed for so many years I shouldn't do. I finally gave in to their crazy approach, and the most amazing thing happened. I was free to go, play, try things, experiment, to live as I had before my ropes. I felt free in a way I hadn't since I was 6 years old. And I accomplished things I never would have imagined possible. I was astounded, proud, liberated, and confused. I wondered if the beliefs that held me back in this class were the same ones holding me back in other parts of my life. The seed had been planted. Maybe I shouldn't believe everything I think. Headset off. To take it off, I just had to realize I had it on. Ropes broken. New beliefs lead to new actions. In my first bold move since I was 6, I turned down my offer to work at a law firm and placed myself in a different reality. I experimented with different jobs and took on various side projects, saying yes to ones I previously would have said no to due to lack of experience, trusting I could figure it out.
All right, you've been listening, and there's about 5 more minutes to go on it, but you were listening to Professor Lauren Weinstein in a TED Talk in Palo Alto. I just felt it was important because I'm sure many people in this audience and in the general population had found themselves in similar situations, allowing something that should not have limited them to do so, and false projections about who they were and how they looked and how they felt, and being influenced by other people who, even though they may want to have your best interests at stake, don't. And this comes back, why I'm playing this in part is because when I was getting a haircut the other day, I was standing right next to a Walmart store and waiting to be picked up to take him back to the filming site. And all I saw were parents bringing obese children, themselves obese, out. And you could see all the junk food that was in their shopping cart. And I thought, wow, these parents are not intending to hurt their children. They love their children. But the consequences of their intentional ignorance is going to be harmful. That kid's going to end up with heart disease and diabetes and frequently be fat shamed. So think of all the other ways other than diet and that where we put ourselves in a self-limiting position. So anyhow, I just wanted to share that with you. We have 5 minutes remaining of our program, and I wanted to open the calls for you to share your thoughts and your points of view. And you can call us at 888-874-4888. 888-874-4888. And while you're thinking about what you'd like to call in and talk about on what we've covered, we're going to play you this last clip about why student debt is out of control.
Don't waste your time looking for someone to blame for the student debt crisis. You know why? So hold my beer and pass me your undivided attention. The college debt story that has us collectively shook goes like this. You took out loans to pay for college because everyone said you need a degree to get a J-O-B. But come graduating time, there wasn't exactly a pot of gold at the end of the jungle juice slip and slide. Take Jane. We all know a Jane, the girl who took out loans to study puppetry or bagpiping.
It's not puppetry, it's puppet arts.
And last you heard, she was living on her mama's couch because all her fine arts degree got her was a job at Applebee's and a student loan bill 6 figures deep. So who's to blame for sentencing Jane to a lifetime of watching Golden Girls reruns with her parents? Well, there's a lot of key suspects. First, there's the government. You know how people always talk about the good old days when you could pay for college with a summer job? Well, a lot of that was thanks to Pell Grants, money that you don't have to pay back. A federal Pell Grant used to cover as much as 77% of your total public college experience. Tuition, room, board, everything. But by 2011, that had fallen to 36%. This sets the stage for our next culprit. Too many student loans. In 1972, Richard Nixon created the Student Loan Marketing Association. You know it as Sallie Mae. At first, it was great. Everyone had the financial freedom to pursue higher education, no matter the size of your wallet, and with a low interest rate to boot. But by the 1980s, trouble was already on the way. The New York Times started calling out the country's burgeoning student loan bill and interviewed experts who were worried that, quote, record borrowing for college threatens the financial stability of a generation of young people and their families. So did we change directions and avoid this problem? No, we doubled down. In 1996, Congress cut a deal to let Sallie Mae transition into a private, for-profit company. Sallie Mae started wilding out. She jacked up interest rates to as high as 28%.
We'll come back to that, but I want to get some colors on them. We have Sandy from New York. Hi, Sandy. You're on the air. What would you like to share with us, please?
Hi, Gary. Thank you for this opportunity. I'm calling about homeschooling because I have a lot of children in my family that have been homeschooled, and they are just amazing human beings who are very happy, who are very excited about meeting people, new projects, just really great kids. But initially, it was started because of the fear of vaccines and also the fear of strangers bringing up, you know, all our children and us not knowing, you know, them anymore. They seem, you know, anyway, that was a fear. But consequently, you know, our family daughters started and have become a very active part of a 500 family co-op. And it's a family learning center for home educated kids. And it turns out to be a lot of fun. They hire really good people who do, like enrichment programs, you know, where they'll have like extra swimming, extra soccer, you know, volleyball, you know, just all kinds of art and photography so that the kids have a lot of skills and you know, being excited about new stuff that the parents usually are not skilled in. But a lot of the parents have regular jobs and homeschool. Some of them have two jobs. And some of the parents are just so excited about being with their kids. And you see the love, Gary. You see the excitement, you know, with the kids and the parents. And I can't tell you, whenever I'm there, I just feel like, wow, you know, this is great. And anyway, I wanted to share that.
Well, thank you, Sandy. And if I'm sure other people have similar points of view. I know that my daughter, Shelley, she chose to homeschool for 4 years because she felt that the environment of just testing without learning had a dominant factor in all the school systems. There are some that don't, like Montessori and some of the really good schools, but a lot of them did. You test to the test, you know, not what you learn. And she wanted her kids to learn. And because as I had taught her, every day we read a classic, and I wanted her to understand the classics and what role they played today. Even when she was 4 years old, she was learning the classics. And she did the same for her children. So her children then were able to socialize with other children who were being homeschooled. All the while, there was this negative stigma about anyone who homeschooled. Oh, they must be, you know, people who are stupid and lazy and incorrigible. Absolutely just the opposite. They were very conscientious, very loving, but they wanted a more authentic education, one that all of us who are baby boomers got. I love the education that we got in our public school system. And also, she wanted her kids to learn morals and manners and respect for people and society that was not common in many of the peer systems and where there was no respect. And people did whatever they wanted. There were a lot of spoiled, and her kids told me. You know, many of our friends were very spoiled. They said anything, did anything. There was no consequence. That wasn't the case with Shelley and her kids. So after they had attended homeschool for 4 years, then they transferred into regular system, and they all ended up doing very well and are happy and balanced and healthy today. And Amber, my family member, she is a very strong environmental activist and a scientist in New Jersey. You see her at the demonstrations. She writes scientific papers. That's the consequence. So, Sandy, your statement just now about those 500 families, I was not aware of those 500 families, but good for them. And I believe that with the degradation of our school system, no fault of the teachers, but an awful lot of the fault of the administrators, the system, the corruption, the unions, and overseeing it, and a lot of the parents, that I don't like it when a teacher cannot teach the proper curriculum and help evolve character and principles of real learning in a classroom where they're fearful. So, good for you, and good for all the other people out there who are homeschooling. We're out of time, and you can finish listening on prn.fm. to the Why Student Debt is Out of Control. It's a very good piece. It's only 5 minutes long. You heard 3 minutes. You can hear the last two. And I look forward to sharing more tomorrow, everyone. Have a nice day.
It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will.